So, how are you doing today? Good?
It's an honor to talk to you, man. We're going to have a good time. Well, let's run the music, Jim, and we'll hit it. Here we go. Mission given to me by Woody Shaw, Sunship, Dizzy, and John Kahn. Dedicated to pursuing a piece of our cultural heritage through interviews with my music heroes, this is The Jake Feinberg Show. Welcome, everybody, inside the Jim Brady Broadcasting Studios at 25 East Glen. This is The Jake Feinberg Show. Thanks for all being part of the program today. People talk about... People talk about the British invasion as the Beatles, that the Beatles encouraged original songwriting and individuality. They also are given credit for introducing Indian music and polyrhythms to our humble land. But what about those who don't sing on Macklemore Avenue or croon like James Taylor, but rather play melodic invention? The fusing of all genres of music before there was any idiomatic labeling. These types of artists are mercurial, sometimes misunderstood, like Miles Davis, who hired my guest because he wanted him to be himself, play what he felt because Miles knew he had to give creative freedom to his sidemen in order to get the bitches brew. The same thing like the Lawrence of Newark, Larry Young, or Tony Williams, or Ted Dunbar. My guest grew into himself because he gave himself up to Sri Chinmoy with love, surrender, and devotion to his craft. The God inside him and an inner mounting flame of angst that pushes him to the brink and brings him back. Let yourself go, lose yourself, and come back to find yourself. Harness the ego, defend originality, and breathe. What's my guest's philosophy? From my desert view, it seems to be experimentation, being able to see dreams, envision them, and then seize them. Keep pushing the boundaries of mortality in music. He does this by surrounding himself with others who have a lot to convey. He is not afraid of the discussion, even if Jean-Luc Ponty goes off for 15 minutes. My guest lets artists get stuff off their chest, mind. He is not interested in stifling others. He learned this practicing meditation and playing music with Brian Auger, Jack Bruce, and Dave Holland, fellow British invaders themselves. Like his kids and mine, he has learned to share, take turns, and devote your prowess to opening minds through melodic invention, even if it's time out of mind. His playing is prolific, he is deeply spiritual, and instead of the spoken word, he can reflect this spirituality through his music and all the cats he has collaborated with. Cats from here, cats from there, cats from everywhere found their unique voice through playing with others all day at Baggies or in some small loft on the lower west side of Manhattan, not even aware that the sun has come and gone, eating a couple of sandwiches with Billy Cobham. Perpetual evolution through sequencing of ideas, staying in the moment as the flame burns higher and higher and you learn to stop trying to control things. You surrender to your true nature, the spirit inside you, which is transcendent and appreciated by legions of musicians and music lovers. Mahavishnu John McLaughlin, happy Memorial Day, and welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show.
That was some build-up, Jay. Man, well, what can I say?
Well,
all lies.
All, you know, exactly. And that's cool because this is just poetry that comes out of my head trying to...
No, it's beautiful. It's beautiful. It's wonderful. I enjoy listening to you. It's like hearing about somebody else.
I want to ask you something. First off, I don't think this gets a lot of exposure, but when you first started playing live gigs in London or wherever, were you playing with any black organ players? Were there any like jazz trios that you started with? I'd love to know some of those early live shows.
Yeah, I mean, in those days, really, the guitar trio, the organ trio, which is Hammond organ, guitar, and drums, was everywhere, and so I was very much part of it, which was one of the reasons why I was thrilled when I came over to New York to play with Tony, discovered that Khalid Yassin was in the band, Larry Young,
sure.
the great Larry Young. Because that organ trio was marvelous. The only black musicians I played with in the UK was I had a band with some South African musicians who kind of escaped the apartheid. Dudu Pakwana, alto sax player Louis Maholo, a drummer Johnny Biondi, bass player.
What year was that?
Oh, this would be 1967, 66.
Dudu Pukwana. I know that name from... That was like Hugh Masekela's guy, Dudu Pukwana. I know that guy.
Dudu Pukwana, yeah.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Oh, no, unbelievable.
Great player, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. So, marvelous players over in South Africa. Yeah, because, the whole apartheid thing, a lot of South Africans escaped, fortunately, and they made it over to... Britain at that time, but black Americans were few and far between as far as playing with them concerned. The only lucky chance I got was I got to play. I had a gig in Belgium with a great Belgian guitar player at that time, René Thomas, his name was, and the trumpet player was Art Farmer.
Oh, wow.
He was a lovely, lovely player, wow. Lovely musician. And it was just one gig, but it was a thrill. But as far as really hitting the jazz scene, I was going around Europe and running into musicians every now and then, but it was really when I got to New York that things really took off. Playing with Tony and then being snatched by Miles the day after, that was, what musician could ask for more, really?
Well, but you, this is what I like to get at, is that someone like you, all the other cats that I've interviewed as well, it seemed to me that you guys were street scholars in a lot of ways. You had a lot of opportunities to play in live venues in front of lots of different people. And to me, that helped you create your individual sound. It helped you create that individuality. And I, being that I was born in 1978, I want to know if that thesis is correct in that, like nowadays, not so much in France or in Europe, I can't speak to that, but you go to Los Angeles today, John, there's one jazz club left. There's no venues to play live, and therefore people are left to their own devices of the technology of saying, and there's all this information out there, whereas before, all you really had was the radio and to go see people live. Otherwise, you had to develop your own individuality. So tell me if I'm right about that.
No, you're absolutely right. The situation from clubs and record industries basically dead, isn't it? It's not. It's dead as far as the jazz musician is concerned. As a consequence of that, the club scene and the whole philosophy of exposing people to music, which was how it was in the late 60s and 70s, because I remember even in the 70s, when I think of the different bands, the band Shakti. Can you imagine this opening to what was the name? Metallica?
You're right. It happened.
But the whole idea, one of the first tours Mahavishnu Orchestra did was opening up to the Eagles. You know, but it was beautiful because they were a fantastic band. Lifetime opened up to The Who in Boston once.
Oh my!
You know, I mean, it was a marvelous philosophy, really, that the promoters had. The promoters believed in exposing people to music so that they could get turned on and, you know, and become part of the listening audience to different kinds of music. And it was a marvelous period. And of course, we look today, I mean, how many clubs are there? You know, there's the Blue Note in Tokyo and Osaka, and there's one in New York where I played last year.
Here's the question.
America,
you know, I
so many clubs just in New York, but gone.
But what you're hitting really on is so key, you know, and this is what I want to ask you is that why at that time, maybe you couldn't, you were just marinating in it, but the question is, why was there such an open-minded philosophy towards saying, we're going to put, you know, a folk rock group? I interviewed Richard Green, who is a violinist with C Train, and I guess the promoters in 72 said, well, you got Jerry Goodman as a violinist, and you got Richard Green, and he said that basically he finished his set and just sat behind Billy's drum kit and just the perspiration was flying off of him. But the audience gets to go from a folk rock group to, you know, an amalgamation of you know, enlightened music with Mahavishnu. What do you think that did? I mean, people had spiritual experiences. That's what music is, John. It's not this static thing with labels. You know this, but that's what's driving me crazy about the idea of saying, okay, we only have a jazz club, so we need to just play whatever they think jazz means. That's what they have to play. I don't think the Tony Williams Lifetime, that you couldn't pigeonhole that kind of music.
Well, you know, you got to remember that people, you know, the jazz, some of the jazz musicians, they'd come and listen to Lifetime. They say, this ain't jazz. You know? But they said the same thing with the Mahavishnu Orchestra. But the thing is, you know, as to quote Miles, jazz is a white man's word.
Right, you know? That's right.
It's a very appropriate response to that. Because, you know, these purists who think they know what the real McCoy is, how do they know what is real jazz and what is not? It's their personal preferences. If it sounds like something they enjoy, then that's the real thing. I mean, come on. But the problem is we've got purists everywhere. The other aspect for me that I see was this fragmentation of jazz and the promotion. It's like, you know, jazz rock. Okay, I was there at the beginning. But then you've got funky jazz, and you got cool jazz, and you got smooth jazz. And cool jazz,
right?
And they're all being distilled, and because I listen to, you know, I'll go on the internet. I mean, it's hard even to buy a record anymore, but I'll go onto the internet and listen to some of the what they call jazz, smooth jazz, and there's so little to me that reflects the criteria by which I would say that's real jazz. But of course, I've got my own personal preferences also, Jane, haven't I? You know, I mean, I come out in the 60s, I come up with Miles, Coltrane, Sonny Rollins, you know, Pharoah Sanders, Cecil Taylor, Archie Shepp, you know, that whole wild 60s.
Unbelievable.
It was an unbelievable situation. And then we had, you know, and you mentioned the Beatles before, and they were highly original, and they were, I love the Beatles, I love them to this day, because they were original, and they were new, and it was refreshing to hear great lyrics that meant somebody that were not like, you know, if I don't see you, baby, I'm gonna die.
Exactly.
You know, I mean, real poignant lyrics, and you know, and then you had bands like Sly and the Family Stone. I mean, and I saw them in 69, one of the greatest concerts I ever saw, bar none. You know what I mean? And they're not a jazz band, but who cares? that it's great music. And in the end, that's what we look for. But in jazz today, it's true. It's very difficult for me to isolate some of the young musicians and say this guy is going to be really something. There are some great musicians around, but I don't see any of these great personalities that I grew up with in the 60s.
I think
for me, they're like great men. Okay, they're my heroes, but they came out with this so new forms and new conceptions and new ways of playing, and it was fabulous. And well, you listen to basically jazz today. Unless, of course, I don't want to generalize, because there are some great young musicians. I know that. I mean, and the level of musicians. I try to help young musicians, because they write to me, and they send their files to me. And if I can do something for them, I do it, because the music's given me everything. I've got to hand it on. But it's difficult for me to say this is the real jazz, because I grew up with different criteria. It's a tough call for me.
I just want to say
young musicians, great young musicians, and they're great. I mean, for example, like but they've been around a while. People like Brad Mehldau, he's the younger generation, but highly original. You get someone like Gonzalo Rubalcaba, beautiful player, but they've been around. I mean, Gonzalo's been around for 30 years too, but I'm waiting to hear somebody come out with a new form, a new refreshing form that's based on the criteria that I grew up with.
I want to just say one thing, John, because I this is such a classic interview. My name is Jacob, so call me Jake, not Jay. Jacob, Jake.
Okay.
Yeah. So.
Well, Jacob, if you want, yeah, fine with me.
It's a little too biblical. I Jake Feinberg just kind of just for legacy purposes. I don't want people to. I've had I've interviewed David Grisman, the mandolin player,
okay.
And he, at the end of our conversation, after an hour and 40 minutes, he said to me, I mean, literally, we had this incredible interview, and then we're getting off the phone, and he says, "What's your name again?" So I don't. I want to make sure you know who it's Jake, but. The thing is,
it's called old age. Right?
No, but here's the thing. So what
you're gonna have to forgive me, okay?
I forgive you. I forgive you, of course. But here's the thing. I think what you and we haven't gotten to it yet, but I think part of the originality from you speak about two things that stood out to me. One was just the leadership that was there. Dizzy, Duke, Miles. Woody Herman, it didn't matter. Those guys were leaders and set the other thing though was, and you had there was Maharishi Maresh Yogi on the West Coast, and you tapped into a very special cat on the East Coast. And can you pronounce his name for me? Like Jake, what is Sri Chinmoy? Is that it?
Chinmoy, yeah, like Chin with a moy at the end, yeah.
Now listen,
like he
guru, let you
my meditation guru for 5 years he was.
And you look at the co-joining of the spiritual and the letting and all the stuff that he taught you, and then what that put into your playing, all of a sudden, that is what that you have a tremendous, when you fuse that love with the music, you got it. And for everybody in that group, Larry Young, Miroslav, Joe Chambers, the list goes on and on and on. All those guys, it was all spiritual connected with, it wasn't just learning in a classroom, and to me, so I can't discount this idea of these incredible gurus that you gravitated to at a certain period. I guess the question I have for you is when you first saw him in a small gym or wherever you saw him in Queens or the Bronx, what was it that immediately hooked you into what he was thinking about, what talking about?
Well, I think we're going to have to go back to a few years prior to that, because, in the mid-60s with the Beatles, and not just the Beatles, but everybody was tripping. We were all tripping. It was, what they call now the psychedelic period.
Sure.
And And these are, I mean, you read a book like The Doors of Perception by Aldous Huxley, in which he describes, he writes, a very erudite and wonderful, beautiful human being. He writes about an experience he had after taking acid. And we all came out of that around 1967 with the desire, and I was not alone. I mean, the Beatles were there. Coltrane was already deep into it, basically finding a way to alter the state of consciousness without taking chemicals, okay?
Right.
And the only way to do that is through meditation, yoga practices, which were not so common in those days. The only thing that was really around that was becoming available were certain teachers from Asia, from India in particular. Maharishi Mahesh Yogi was one of them, and his. I just saw a movie of David Lynch when he was propagating this philosophy in a beautiful way, really too, and so. By 1967, I started to do yoga, and because I wanted to get out of that whole drug thing. I don't even consider LSD drugs or mescaline or these buttons. It's all a very messed up situation as far as perception of drugs is concerned.
I agree.
In the meantime,
I agree.
Yesterday, the drug business is $600 billion a year, so people, they definitely want to get high. The government's... They should recognize that fact and move in and move the drug barons out. In any event, I became very, very much involved in the search towards Asia, because the questions that I started to ask myself were the great existential questions of life, like who am I, what am I, what am I doing here, what's this universe, what's God, you know, the big questions. And and once you start asking these questions, you really should follow through, because they're the basic questions of life, in my opinion, of course.
Mm-hmm.
So I got involved with Indian, then I got involved with the Sufis, which is the mystic school of Islam, which is very, very beautiful. I know Islam has got a very bad reputation, undeservedly, because it's just from a handful of fundamentalists. But I was very much a part of that. And so by the time I met Sri Chinmoy, I'd been practicing yoga for about 2 years already.
Mm.
So I was very much sensitized to stuff like that. In any event, I went to see him in a meditation somewhere in Connecticut. And at the end, he said, you know, anybody want to ask me a question? And I said, yeah, you know, I said, I'd like to speak about the relationship between spirituality, the spirituality, you know, personal spirituality, spiritual development, and music. And he said, that's a very nice question. He said, but at the same time, I should tell you that yes, you can use music as a way to self-enlightenment, but he says, you can do it sweeping the street, too. He said, everything depends on the way you look at it and how you do it. You know, this was very significant to me. It was a very powerful answer to that question, because I realized after that it doesn't matter what you do. You can peel potatoes and cook or do burgers, but how do you do it? Do you do it with joy? Do you do it with a sense of freedom? You know, because it's all the way we look at things. Everything is the way we perceive. And this was a real eye-opener. And so I went and studied meditation with him for the following 5 years, which I've never regretted. And even though I left his particular path in 75, this was really because I wanted to assume... how shall I say, responsibility for my own development.
Right, right.
And that's this continued until this day, and it will continue until I keel over, Jake.
Jake.
You know, because I'm going to keel over one day, you know, and I'm still here at 72. I mean, I'm amazed. These blows my mind because I still feel 29 inside.
Oh, I love it.
Machine,
no, because it's the soul, you know.
It's not the same.
I mean, to me, it's a little bit scary. You said something in another interview I was reading about when you get to that point when you have to let go of the drugs and you are practicing meditation and breathing. And you said it gets to a point where it's either exhilarating or scary. Either way, that's a good thing, you said, because you have to confront who you are and what you're dealing with. And
we've all got this. You know, even the eagle said it. We've got a few demons. You know, I don't use the word demon as like, you know, in the biblical sense.
Right.
But you know, I mean, we've all got this kind of there's a dark side to everybody because it's the ego, isn't it? It's selfish. Mm. I want me, mine, ego. You know, and everybody's got one. If you're alive, you got one, unless you're sane. You know, very few of those around. You know, and the thing is, is to recognize it's the whole point. You know, and even the saints they got ego trips too. You know, I mean, the perfection is all relative, isn't it? You know, I think only the infinite is perfect, and the infinite belongs inside everybody. So in a way, we are all perfect. The whole universe is perfection itself. But, of course, because of the ego and the way we perceive things, you know, that kind of it screws things up royally, too. But the whole thing, what you were talking about originality, this actually is the question of life. I mean, the question of life is the same as the question of art. You know, who am I, after all? And how do I feel about the people around me? How do I feel about myself? How do I feel about my relationship to all of these people and the universe and God, this universe, infinite spirit? How do I feel about all that? You know, and do I recognize it? And do I harmonize with these all of these things? So, and this is part, because in jazz in a way pushes you to that point, because you have to improvise in jazz.
Mm-hmm.
Without improvisation, jazz doesn't exist. But what are you going to say, Jake? What are you going to say when you start improvising? And there's only one thing we all can say. The only thing we can talk about is our life story. And so the following question comes in, well, how rich is it?
Yeah.
How rich is your interior life? You know, and how deep is it? How deep do you feel? How deeply do you care about these great questions of life and your existence here and your relationship with these people? How deeply do you care about it? And I think this is really the crux of the matter. And you know, and I just to bring another little anecdote, because I had the great fortune to tour in 1970s, late 1970, with the great Alice Coltrane.
Oh.
We did some gigs together.
Wow.
And we were talking, of course, about, I was very much involved with my meditation trip, and Alice is, what a woman she is. And we were just talking after one concert, and, you know, about this and that, and about enlightenment, you know, and the wonders of the mystery of existence and all that. She said, you know, John, in the end, it comes down to one thing, you know, how much are you ready to suffer for love? And I thought, well, what a beautiful thing. It just like nails everything, doesn't it? Marvelous.
Unbelievable. You know, listen, we play a game on this program called Name That Tune. I want to play you a piece of music, see if you can peg it, and then we'll come back and talk about it.
Well, I'm going to have to leave. I'm sorry. I actually have a dinner date tonight. It's 20-7 here.
Oh,
I'm gonna have to move.
Oh, I,
are we? Are you cool with that?
Well, I
no, you're not cool with
no.
It.
I would know because a lot of my interviews tend to. Is there a chance we could pick it up again? Because I didn't get to some of the stuff that I really did want to get to.
Well, I do ramble on, Jake, don't I? But, you know, I think maybe that you want me to ramble a little bit. The thing is, I got to go to Munich tomorrow. I'll be gone a couple of days. I'll be back later in the week. I can give you another 20 minutes, 30 minutes later on in the week.
That's fine. When should I contact you?
This Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. I'm back Thursday. So, I've got,
Do you want to try?
No, I'm gonna have to.
You want to try Friday or the week?
Maybe Thursday night might be better. But can you give me an email?
Yes.
Just to confirm it, because I'm gonna have to look at my agenda. No, I'm sorry. I didn't know. It goes on for about 30 minutes.
No, my interviews tend to. We were just warming up. let me give you my email.
Yeah.
It's Jake, J-A-K-E.
Yeah.
Feinberg, F, like in Frank. E-I-N.
F, I in friend.
F, like friend.
F, Jake Feinberg.
Yeah, F-E-I-N.
I-N. B-E-R-G.
Show, S-H-O-W.
So, one second.
Yep.
Jake, F-E-I-N-B-E-R-G.
Yes.
Correct?
Show, yeah. So, it's Jake Feinberg Show, S-H-O-W, at G... All one word, Jake Feinberg Show, at gmail.com.
Oh, okay. Got it.
Okay. Yeah, no. Okay. If it doesn't happen this week, it just, there's, I would love another half hour so we could go through Argan's bag and
that would be better because I go to Munich tomorrow for a couple of days, but on Friday I have to leave for Vienna, where they have an unbelievable event to raise awareness about AIDS, you know. And there's a lot of great people there, and I have to play. It probably would be better next week for me. Is that okay?
Because Arjun Gorder.
Okay.
We got a lot of stuff to do. So just do me a favor, email me and let me know. This is a good time for you, though. 6 p.m. your time is normally a good time?
Yeah, it's
okay.
Good.
Just,
it's good, yeah.
Hey, man, good to hear your voice, and safe travels.
Okay, Jake.
Okay?
Yeah.
Talk to you soon. Yeah.
Bye-bye. Yeah, bye.
Bye.